I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Kenneth Fearing's study of a deadly obsession. Desperate Witness. Starring Richard Kramer. Keenan and Wynn. And Julie Adams. Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
General Motors, Delco Electronics, and Sinoff. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
There's a nursery rhyme that refers to the mouse that ran up the clock. That clock is marking time, and time stops for no man. George Stroud, executive editor of Crimeways magazine, will now conduct a search for a man. A man who saw someone enter an apartment building the night of a murder. A desperate witness he alone knows to be himself. Our story will continue in a moment.
If I picked the right kind of staff, twisted the investigation where I could, jammed it where I had to, pushed hard where it was safe, it might be a long time before anybody connected me with George Chester. Hopefully before that I could turn suspicion where it belonged, to the real murderer, Janet. Roy Cordette got them all together for me. I'd rely on Roy the heaviest. His office was next to mine. Also, he had the most analytical mind, so I wanted to keep my eye on him. I was behind my desk, playing it cool. The secure executive, as they all trooped in.
Ed
Orland, Don Klausmeier, Leon Temple, Nat Sterling, and Roy.
I've briefed everybody, George, to drop whatever they're currently doing.
Fine. Thanks, Roy. Now, you're all being asked to take on a rather strange job. It has to be done quickly and quietly. I know I can rely on you. We've been given a blank check as far as the resources of the organization are concerned. If we need help on your particular assignments, just ask. Raid any department you need. Something special, come to me or to Roy here, who's second in command.
What's it about?
We're looking for somebody, Leon.
Oh.
Right now, we'll call him X. We don't know much about him. His name may be George Chester. It's possible he's in advertising. That'll be your assignment, Nat. Combing ad agencies, clubs, PR offices, newspapers, etc., etc., etc. Leon, check all real estate registers, tax records, public utilities, phone books of cities within, say, 300-400 miles for a George Chester.
Yeah.
Take all the people you need to help you.
I've got it.
Now, all we've got is a name, and we're not even sure of that. We haven't even got a good description of him. Just say he's of average height, say 5'9 to 11, average build, probably between 140 and 190.
That's not much to go on.
Well, he's apparently a regular of a place on 3rd Avenue called Gill's. He was supposedly there last Saturday afternoon with a woman that we know to be a good-looking blonde. That's all we know about her. Now, that'll be your job, Ed. Find this joint, whatever it is, and when you do, stay there until our Mr. X comes into it. Now, on the same evening, our subject went into an antique shop, also on 3rd Avenue. That'll be your gig, Don.
All you've told us about this man took place last Saturday. Wasn't that the night Pauline Dulles was killed? She's connected with Janet. He was in Washington. Is that what this is about?
No, no connection. Not as far as I know. It's purely a big-time business scandal that Hagen himself and a few others have been digging into. Now it's due to break.
Yeah, well, I just thought it's quite a coincidence.
No.
Do we make inquiries about the blonde woman who was with this guy?
Yeah, you'll all have to do that. But we're not looking for the woman or any other outside person. It's the man we want. Only the man. All right?
Yeah.
No more questions?
Sure.
I suppose you intellectual tramps get out of here and get to work.
Okay. Bye.
They were gone, except Roy. His was the sharpest, most analytical mind, my greatest hazard. I could feel the wheels in his head turning. I waited while he walked around the desk, then crossed to the wall, facing it, hands thrust into his pockets. He leaned against the wall, staring at the carpet.
George, this is a crazy affair. I can't help feeling Don hit the nail on the head.
How do you mean?
It's a curious connection there, the fact that all of this happened last Saturday.
I don't understand.
Well, I don't mean it has any connection with Pauline Dulles' murder. Of course it hasn't. That'd be a little too obvious. But I can't help thinking that something, I don't know what, something happened last week on Friday or Saturday, perhaps while Janeth was in Washington, that would really explain why we're looking for this mysterious art-collecting stranger at this particular moment and in such a hurry. What do you think?
Sounds logical.
There's a rumor that Janeth Enterprises is in real financial trouble. That's why he went to Washington. Did you know that?
No, I didn't.
Well, it's confidential. Don't ask me how I learned of it, but Janeth could be fighting a buyout or a merger.
He was standing against the wall, and I was suddenly aware of the picture above his head as though it screamed at me. My whole staff out looking for a man who collected Pattersons? Well, the Pattersons stared right back at me. It had hung on my wall so long, I no longer saw it. I'd bought it at the Lewis Galleries 2 years back, a profile of two faces showing only the brow, eyes, nose, lips, chins, facing each other in confrontation. In style, unmistakably Patterson. The artist called it Study and Fury.
I keep thinking the man we're looking for could very well be tied to the Janet Donahue group.
Janet Donahue?
Yeah, off the record, they're the ones trying to break Janet Enterprises. Think I ought to, on the side, follow up on that?
Good idea. Good idea, Roy. Hell of a good hunch. Follow it up and stick with it.
He was hooked for now on a false lead. I held my breath as he moved from the wall, but he didn't glance at the Patterson painting. Closed the door and went back to his own office. When he was gone, I sat for a long time, feeling the aftershock in beads of perspiration all over me. Painting, staring at me all the time I had given orders to find me. It was dangerous, but it would have to stay there. No one had noticed it, but if I moved it, its absence would cry out like a banshee. Now it would have to stay there on the wall, even though at any moment someone might make the connection. I'd always liked that painting. Now it was a threat. And that Patterson I'd taken home, my wife had seen it. Once I'd got over the initial shock of having dispatched an army of leg men to track myself down, I began to feel more secure. I had one great advantage. I alone knew where each one of them was at all times. I could evaluate the bits and pieces they brought me, could divert their direction, keep them from comparing notes, and discredit anything that got too close for comfort. I'd be under the big clock from now on. It was a desperate race between the police, Janet, and myself. Would the police get to me before they got to Janet? Could I get to Janet before Hagen got to me? I sent Maverson to cover the police. I couldn't send one of my own staff. They were too crime-wise. Maverson was an intellectual on Future Way staff. Send him to cover a murder story, he'd end up writing a philosophical piece about prison reform. He'd been on staff 10 years, probably hadn't spoken 100 consecutive words to anybody. Anything Maverson dug up would be for my ears only. And that's what I wanted. He came into my office, his plump face, as usual, vague. His expression an eternal puzzlement.
They took me off my assignment, and I was doing a piece on molecular structure.
Emery, I'm involved in a special outside job. The whole staff's working on it. But at the same time, one of the most sensational murders of the year has occurred. Pauline Dulles. You must have read the newspaper account.
Oh, I believe I glanced at it. Oh, isn't she, Jenna's lady friend?
Wasn't she? Right. Well, this special assignment's taking all our time around here, but we can't let Crimeways be left at the post.
We can't let a big story like the Dulles murder get away from us.
Well, I'm sorry. I don't understand where I'd fit in.
Look, the usual policy would be to break it, give it a big play, 20 or 30 leg men. This time, since my guys are busy, we'll do the reverse. I want you to go in there quietly, alone.
You want me to cover it?
A totally different approach. Fresh. You'll bring it something new, sensitive, not the usual expose. I want you to keep this assignment to yourself, because I still haven't sold it upstairs, you know what I mean?
Well, a crime story, that's so out of my experience.
Start at Center Street, Homicide Bureau. Pick up everything as and when it happens. Phone in to me, and me only, everything. I want to be kept up to date on every phase of the Dulles story.
Well, now, will this be all right with Hagen? You know, he put me on future
ways. Don't worry, now, I'll fix it with Hagen. And I'll fix it with Janice, too. That's the beauty of a monolithic organization. The right hand doesn't suspect what the left hand's doing. By the time Hagen found out about Mafferson, I'd either be in the clear, or it'd be too late for me anyway. I rode down to the garage, got into my car, and drove off, intending to go straight home and get rid of that painting I'd bought. But I turned down a side street, and I found myself heading toward Pauline's apartment. It was the first I'd been there since that night. All this energy spent trying to plot my own survival, and I hadn't really stopped to think about her. The image of that beautiful neck, broken, and perfect body, lifeless. I had to pull over to the curb, pull myself together, force my mind to look for a weakness, a flaw in Janice's alibi. There had to be one. I went back over Saturday night, every step. I'd just taken Pauline home. My car's parked around the corner. I let her off. I'm not going to the lobby, so far as anyone in the building knows, I don't exist. I'm a distance off. I see Janice drive up. He gets out of his car. He catches up with Pauline. He goes in with her. And what did he do after that? He killed her. Then he had to get away. But he'd sent his chauffeur on. How'd he get to Steve Hagen's? I drove the logical route from Pauline's to Hagen's. Saw two nearby cab stands. Janice could have used one of them if he'd taken a taxi to Hagen's. Unless he found a cruising cab. He certainly wouldn't have been so stupid as to pick one up at Pauline's door. The farthest cab stand was the likeliest. I'd begin there, and then I'd try the nearer. No, it was dangerous. Because cabbies talk to cops. No, not yet. I'd have to be careful and wait. I got back to my office just as Roy called in the first report. Hello?
It's Roy, George. Listen, I'm at Gill's Tavern with Ed Orlin. It's a nut house. You know, this guy's got a museum here that looks like...
So what'd you find out?
Well, the bartender, who's the chief lunatic around here, described our man as intelligent, eccentric.
You sound like you don't agree.
Eccentric, yes, but only a moron would come into a dump like this and spend hours talking to the guy who runs this menagerie.
Is that all?
Well, physical description we have doesn't seem far wrong. Nothing to add to it except he's brown-haired, clean-cut.
Anything on the blonde?
Nothing.
It certainly isn't much, is it?
Well, wait. Our man is unquestionably a lush.
Who?
4 or 5 years ago, he was in here every night. Had to be sent home in a cab. At that time, he was a newspaper man. Bartender never heard of him working in advertising. Before he was a newspaper man, he ran a tavern upstate somewhere with his wife. Now, that's all we've got. So what should Ed do? Come back to the office?
No. Our man was in there 2 days ago. He might turn up any minute. No, have Ed work on the bartender. Psychoanalyze him for more details. Have a few drinks with him.
This kook's a human blotter, and he's got some screwy game.
Yeah, well, Ed can get drunk with him, but not too drunk. And tell him to try some of the other customers. What's the address and phone number there? I felt I'd pulled it off pretty well. I'd keep things on ice for a while. Eccentric, huh? Moron? And lush? I never saw that when I looked in the mirror. I touched my shirt. It was soaked with nervous sweat. I was was getting home later and leaving earlier. My wife, concerned with being cook, nurse, and handholder, our daughter had tonsillitis, hadn't seemed to notice that the painting was no longer in the dining room. I hoped she'd forgotten it. I had it stashed in the downstairs closet behind all our raincoats.
George, you're not leaving without your breakfast.
Yeah, I have to, hon. I'll call you.
Darling, I don't like the way you look at all. They're working you too hard. Well, try to get home earlier, dear.
The worry about how close I was to losing my family if the truth came out rode into town with me. Roy wanted me in his office, which had taken on the look of command headquarters for World War III. A big blackboard covered half a wall. Cross-reference charts were propped up on desks, tables. I didn't see Leon Temple right away. He was behind a six-foot chart.
What do you think of it?
You're doing a thorough job, Roy.
I've got our Mr. X charted 10 ways from Sunday, all cross-indexed. Reports have begun coming in. See, under background, he may or may not be in advertising. He used to be a newspaper man. Once operated an upstate tavern resort with his wife. Now, that's just a matter of checking every tavern license back as far as necessary.
Well, it's a start, Roy.
Start? More than that. Leon just worked up a report on the Van Barth. I was just going to put it up on the board. Read it to him, Leon.
Sure. It was established that the man in question, whom we know as George Chester, was in the Van Barth Lounge on Saturday night last, sometime between 9:30 and 10. He was carrying an unframed oil painting, which he did not check, and was overheard talking to his female companion about what the painting should be named. The woman with him was one Pauline Dulles.
Dulles? Are you sure of that?
No doubt about it, George.
Oh, sure, sure.
Leon checked the waiter, bartender, checkroom girl, all three. Identified her from pictures published in the paper. Now, doesn't this alter the whole character of the assignment?
Did the police know Dulles was in there Saturday night?
Of course. Everybody in the place reported it once they saw the papers.
I'm asking Leon.
Oh, yes, they know.
And do the police know that we're looking for the man who was with her?
Well, I didn't give them any information. I followed your exact instructions.
So that's it. And just that they were there.
Oh, no. There's evidence. When they left the cocktail lounge of the Van Barth, our subject left something behind.
What? What did he leave?
Subject's handkerchief. I've got it here in the envelope. The lady spilled her drink.
Let me see that.
I wouldn't touch it, George. We may be able to raise a fingerprint.
From a handkerchief? I doubt that. Anyway, if they can, I imagine it already has plenty. The waiters, the cashiers, yours. One more set won't matter.
Well, even without fingerprints, it can probably be traced. There's a laundry mark on it.
Yeah, well, I'll send it to the lab, Roy. You go on with what you're doing. At least I'd publicly handled the handkerchief. Back in my office, I closed the door of my desk on it. Just as Don Klausmeier came in.
I've got some interesting information, George.
Any luck with the painting?
Yeah, real luck. You know, I found the artist.
No?
She lives in a loft, paradise for rats and termites. Got 4 kids, never was married. The first of the women's libbers.
That's all very interesting. Mm. What's it got to do with our man?
Just this. She's the customer who bid unsuccessfully for her own picture that night. A friend saw a canvas in the shop window and told her. She tried to buy it back, but she'd been broke for years and couldn't match our guy's bid. But she did give a detailed description of him. You know, the artist's eye and all that.
Let's have it.
Yeah, I got the old girl on tape, had it transcribed. Here, let me read it to you.
All right.
I quote Patterson. "The bum that outbid me for my own paintings was a smug, self-satisfied creep just like 10 million other rubber-stamped sub-executives. Brown hair, line of gray at the temple, brown eyes, high cheekbones, symmetrical lean features. Face looks like he'd scrubbed and shaved it 5 times a day. Has one of those $10 hairstylings just over the edge of the ear and curling at the nape of the neck. More establishment than hippie. He's 37, 38, weighs between 160 and 165, 5'10.5". Gray tweed suit, wide red and black necktie striped with white, wears a wide gold wedding band. A good deal of an exhibitionist. Imagines he's Omar Sharif, and that's what he plays at being. The woman with him was beautiful. if you like lesbians in standard Park Avenue models. He knows pictures, especially the works of L. Patterson, which he doubtless collects, but only for their snob appeal. Otherwise, he's a totally obnoxious man. Unquote. Oh, she didn't miss much, huh?
May or may not be a good description. Her opinion, a little biased.
You know, George, when I was poking around that studio loft she lives in, looking at acres of her pictures, they all had kind of the same feel. And it reminded me of something I've seen somewhere else quite recently.
I was staring straight over his head at Louise Patterson's study in fury on the wall behind him.
The only trouble is, I can't remember what it is or where I saw it.
Well, it'll come back to you. Don't worry about it. I'll see you tomorrow. I took him by the arm and ushered him out so he wouldn't have a chance to turn and look at the painting on the wall. I thought of its mate, the temptation of Judas, in the downstairs closet at home behind our raincoats. It could be discovered and easily if they ever caught up with me. If anyone ever got that far, I was finished anyway. Danith and Steve Hagen would take care of that.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Desperate Witness. I'm Rod Serling. George Stroud, on orders from on high, is leading a manhunt for someone he knows to be a witness before the fact to murder. It's only a matter of time, and time cannot be bought. Not like the painting hanging in the office, or the one for which he paid $50 to a junk dealer the night of the murder. For George Stroud, time is running short. In a moment, part four of Desperate Witness, right after this word.
I call Steve Hagen. I would have preferred to see his face when I told him our search led us to a dead woman. But his secretary had said he wasn't available. So I settled for just hearing his reaction.
Yes, George?
Steve, the woman with our man that night was Pauline Dulles. Steve, are you there?
You better come upstairs, George.
They were both there when I walked across those carpeted acres. Steve Hagen seated at his desk, Janice standing behind him. If I thought my face reflected tension, Janice was controlled hysteria. He nodded to me, then he turned and he looked out the window.
George, I've imparted your information to Mr. Janice. He's naturally disturbed. But he agrees with me that there's absolutely no significance in the fact that Pauline Dulles was the man's companion that night. What we want, what we have to have, is the name and whereabouts of the man himself. That's all we're after.
I can't buy that there's no connection.
Well, you have our assurance, Mr. Janice and mine. You see, we've had reason to believe that Pauline knew this go-between, so it's not unnatural that she would have been out with him. Perhaps we should have told you.
Yeah, perhaps you should have.
Listen, Pauline Dulles is a blind alley. Her murder is one story. This is different, unrelated. Now, let's look at some of these other leads a little more closely. We're still checking the list of upstate liquor licenses suspended or not renewed with the board, aren't we?
Yeah, that's a tall order. There are hundreds. The list is being fed straight to me. If I get anything, he'll know immediately.
You seen the story Newsways ran about this Patterson woman?
It's too early for results.
Our spread is going to put that woman on the map. Someone is certain to recognize that Judas painting from our description. Our evaluation of it is priceless, is sure to locate it. It's my hunch that that picture alone will nail our man to the wall.
Those bars, art galleries, and so on.
They're all being covered, Mr. Jones.
Exactly. And why hasn't our man shown by now? No one suddenly abandons his habitual routine of life, not without good reason. Why?
He may be the one who murdered Dulles. In that case, he's not making himself conspicuous. Though he knows he's in fast company, he knows the score, and he's gone to ground, right where he is, so the same thing won't happen to him.
You mean he may believe himself to be in danger?
He knows somebody's playing for keeps. Why shouldn't he be worried? Maybe he saw the killer, can identify him. He's afraid to come forward, knowing he's in for the same.
He's keeping undercover, staying away from all the places he always went before.
How many people in the organization, Stroud, know about this particular job?
What do you mean?
Right here, Janet Enterprises. How many, I'd have guessed?
Well, with 53 people now working on this assignment, I'd say everyone knows about it. The entire 2,000. Why?
And nothing. For a second, I thought I had something. All right. I guess that reports on everything. It's still nothing.
You think I missed a bet somewhere?
Just bear down on it, that's all.
I shall. And now that we've decided the murder and our particular guy belong together, there are a lot more lines we can follow.
What lines?
Well, for one thing, Mr. Janeth, I'll have some men cover all cab stands in the neighborhood of Pauline Dulles' apartment.
Cab stands? Why?
On the night of her death, only a few minutes after it, in fact, somebody took a cab away from that vicinity and couldn't help being rather noticeable. The driver will remember.
I don't follow that.
It's quite simple. Our subject took Pauline to Gill's, then to a number of antique shops, then to the Van Barth. Why wouldn't he take her home? Of course he did. Our timing concurs with the police's. He took her home, then he had to leave. The first and most obvious line to follow is that he left in a taxi.
Perhaps he had his own car.
Huh? Perhaps he did.
He may have walked, taken a bus.
Right. Maybe he did none of these things. But it's my hunch we'll discover he did take a cab. We'll locate the driver. We'll find out where he drove him. And that'll close the whole assignment. The stricken look on Janice's face that came and went screamed his guilt, reassured me that I was right. Janice had taken a cab that night, and it was my only hope of nailing him with the murder. Later that day, Janice went home under doctor's care. The word was he had a strep throat. My bet was that he had a chill brought on by seeing himself with a number on his chest. But I had a chill, too. Brought on by the sure knowledge that if they'd been out to get me before, they'd stop at nothing to cut me down now. I took 3 good recent photographs of Earl Janeth out of the morgue. But I didn't leave the office, even when 5 o'clock rolled around. I stayed, pretending to be bogged down, correlating all the information that had been given to me. By the time I left the office, I really needed a drink. The idea of going into a bar now made me very nervous. I got to the second cab stand, which I figured to be the most likely, about the same hour that Janeth would have taken the cab that Saturday night. I showed Janeth's pictures to the only cabbie waiting at the stand. He didn't want to know who I was or why I was asking.
No. Let me see that other picture. No, I'm sure I never hacked this guy, but maybe my partner. We own a cab together. He works Saturday nights. He could have drove him, you know.
I gave him 3 things. A picture of Janeth, a $20 bill, and the phone number of the office with instructions to talk only to me. The proposition was backed up by another 20 in the offing if he got me the right information. I felt more relaxed for the first time in days when I got home. My family was asleep. I had a drink, and I took the Temptation of Judas painting out of the downstairs closet. My intent was to destroy it, and I couldn't bring myself to do it. It was a work of art, and to destroy a work of art is murder of another kind. So I carried it into the cellar, and I stashed it face to the wall behind the furnace. The horn of the school bus and a small female cyclone swept through the lower rooms of the house, gathering school bag, crayons, picture book, lunchbox, and a hastily scribbled note from her mother explaining her tonsillitis. Her mother and I stood there in the warm sunlight for a moment. The picture of an ordinary, normal, untroubled family. I waved the bus off until I could no longer see it, and I kept waving. I could feel my face locking into deep lines that could hold rainwater.
Are you all right, George?
No, headache, that's all. Just a headache.
George, something is bothering you. I can feel
it. Will you get off my back? Oh, I'm sorry, honey. I'm sorry. It's just a... Oh, it's a lousy mood. You know how it is. It's deadline week.
That's okay. You know, You forgot to bring home a Newsboys last night.
It's not mine. I'll bring one home tonight without fail. In fashion, if you like.
Oh, never mind the Newsboys. I bought one yesterday.
Oh?
You know there's an article in it about this Louise Patterson.
Yeah, I glanced at it.
Fabulous. Just what you've been saying for years. Here. Listen. With all the force of a major explosion, by grace of a new talent, suddenly shooting meteor-like across the otherwise turgid skies of the contemporary art world.
Overwritten.
There's more. Louise Patterson may view her models through a microscope, but the brush she wields is gargantuan. Isn't that grand?
Grand.
Well, they're recognizing a talent. Don't be so critical just because they use different words than you would. At least they admit she's a great painter. Well, for heaven's sake, George, don't pretend you aren't pleased. You must have 7 or 8 Pattersons. Now they're all valuable.
Well, I have to run. I'll drive in. Or do you need the car?
Wait. I want you to hear the rest of this. This week, interest in the art world centered on the whereabouts of one of Patterson's lost masterpieces, her famed Judas. Admittedly, the most highly prized canvas, et cetera, et cetera. This is the part. Depicting 2 huge hands extending a coin, a consummate study in flaming yellow, red, and tawny brown. This composition was widely known some years ago, then it quietly dropped from view, and so on. Well?
Neat, but not gaudy. They make it sound like a rainbow at midnight.
That's not what I'm driving at. Would you know anything about that picture?
No. Well, why should I?
Didn't I see an unframed painting you brought home over a week ago? The night Georgia came down with tonsillitis, didn't I?
Oh, that, yeah. Yeah, well, honey, that wasn't an original. That was only a copy.
Oh, what became of it? It was here in the dining room. I searched everywhere.
I took it to the office. Where do you think those plumbers who call themselves writers got such an accurate description of the original? Now, bye, sweetie. I'll have to step on it. Call you this afternoon. Mafferson met me coming into the building. We rode up together. Fortunately, the elevator was empty except for the two of us. But Mafferson didn't want to talk about what he'd learned at police headquarters. He had another worry. His job.
You think we'll all be fired?
Who gave you that idea?
Well, I ran into this fellow at breakfast. I always stop off at Schraff's in the morning. Fred Stichel's his name. Managing editor of Jeanette Donahue. Never did like that man, and he's even more obnoxious now that he's in a position of power. He was almost as insulting as the night when I tried to call you. A week ago Saturday, the night of the murder, as it turns out. I couldn't reach you, so I called Steve Hagen. Stichel says our magazines are going to fold.
Wait a minute. Just what time did you call Steve?
10:30, 10:45. Strange, isn't it? Police records say that's about the time she was killed.
And you talked to Steve Hagen? He was home?
Yes, in his apartment. Talk to Janet, too.
Janet?
Yeah. What's strange about that? He'd been there all evening, came direct from the airport. They were having a business meeting and told me not to worry about my job.
I wanted to yell. Mafferson backing Janet's alibi. Well, I had to find that cab driver. My mind was racing with a need. We were in my office, but I couldn't remember reaching it. Mafferson was dutifully giving me his police report, and I wasn't listening until I heard the word...
Albany.
What?
I said, the police know Dulles was out of town from last Friday until late Saturday. They found out where she was from a book of matches in her apartment. Came from a nightclub in Albany that doesn't circulate its matches. And in the course of a routine checkup with the Albany hotels, they found out where she'd stayed and what name she'd used.
Oh, really?
Incidentally, the police know all about this job you've been doing here, and they're convinced the man you're looking for and the man with Dulles last weekend in Albany is one and the same. Does that help or hinder our story?
Yeah, go on.
Oh, that's about all. They're sending a man up there this afternoon or tomorrow morning with a lot of photographs to check out with the nightclub, the hotel, and elsewhere. I told you they had the Dulles woman's address book, didn't I?
Mm.
They've been rounding up pictures of every man she knew, and most likely the Albany guy is one of them. Do you follow me?
Yeah, I follow you.
They know from the general description they got over the phone from the hotel personnel that the man most definitely was not Janet. At the hotel, they were registered as Mr. and Mrs. Andrew Phelps Guillaume. Oh, by the way, your name was in her address book. Did you know that?
My wife and I met her at a couple of parties.
Now, if I may digress from these facts to a more philosophical evaluation...
You're doing a good job, Emery. Don't evaluate. Just keep compiling facts. Oh, by the way, is the department looking for a photograph of me?
Oh, they already have one. Off your driver's license application. The man they're sending upstate has quite a collection. 50 or 60 photographs.
I see.
Now, I can go to Albany with him if you like. You know, expedite things and...
No. I want you to start working up that story. I could feel the big clock's hands spinning, hurling me faster and faster. Any minute now, it would tell me my time was up. The two lines of investigation, the organizations and the police, were drawing steadily together like pincers. I could feel them closing. I told myself it was just a vast machine, and the machine was blind. But I hadn't fully realized its crushing weight and power. I returned to my desk from a lunch I could not remember having tasted.
Oh, Mr. Stroud, here's that list of non-renewed licenses from out-of-town taverns you asked for. It's from 10 years back.
Oh, thanks, Lucille.
I haven't had a chance to go through an alphabetize, and yet if you want to leave them with me...
No, later, thanks. One of them would have my name on it, and my wife's. I carried them to my desk, figuring I'd feed them to the paper shredder. But Roy's door into my office was open. He was standing in it. For the moment, I consigned the file folder to my bottom drawer.
Been meaning to ask you, George, did you send that handkerchief to the lab to check possible fingerprints and have the laundry mark run down?
No, I'm sorry, Roy. I forgot.
You give it to me, will you? I'll do it right away.
Yeah, sure. I've got it right here on my desk.
Oh, and Hagen called. I want you to come right up.
These conferences with Hagen had daily become longer, more frequent, more bitter. It was cold comfort to have a clear understanding of the abyss that Hagen and Janet, particularly Janet, saw yawning before them. I wasn't thinking about Janet, but about myself when I opened Hagen's door. I found myself staring at a photographic blow-up of the painting I'd hidden in my cellar at home.
We're going to run it on the cover of Newsways next issue, with a follow-up story on the artist.
But the cover, is she that significant?
She's not. We have our own reasons for running the story. The first article on the artist generated a lot of reader interest. Now we run this lead. Priceless painting disappears. That'll pull our man out of the woodwork. Somebody will turn him in. Someone who knows he has the picture.
Hagen, who hadn't touched anything as plebeian as layout in the 15 years he'd risen to the top of Janet's empire, was meticulously laying out the copy on his desk. I stared over his shoulder at a 4x6 photo displaying one wall of a Louise Patterson exhibition 9 years back in the Miller Gallery. In the middle, surrounded by four other paintings, was the two hands of the Temptation of Judas. But it was another painting that grabbed my throat and squeezed the air out of me. Two faces, two profiles facing one another in confrontation called Study and Fury. This painting at that very moment was hanging, as it had for 2 years, on the wall of my office just 6 floors below. By the time Newsways went to press, anyone who'd wandered in and out of my office since this insanity began was sure to make the connection. If I lasted until Newsways went to press.
George, what the devil's wrong? This thing has drifted more than a week. Why haven't we found our man?
I just shook my head and walked out. By the time I got back to my office, they were all there. Roy, Leon Temple, Phil Best, a couple of other leg men. It was apparent the second I stepped into the room that there'd been a break.
George, we've got him.
Where? Where is he?
Right here.
Here?
Go on, tell him, Leon.
Our man came into this building just a little while ago, right after lunch.
I don't understand. Why would he come in here? Who is he?
We don't know yet, but we've got him. Leon slipped some cash to the staff of the Van Bart, let them know there'd be more.
Incidentally, I need my expense account.
Will you skip the non-essentials, please?
Boy, what Leon's trying to tell you, George, is that the staff of the Van Bart have all been scouting around this district in their free hours. After all, the Van Bart's only 3 blocks from here. And one of their porters picked up our guy and followed him right into this building.
couldn't get over Roy's eyes. Calm, unflappable Roy. And his eyes blazed with evangelical zeal. All of them, all the men in that room, lusting for blood like hunters who'd treat an animal. And I was the animal. I was saying things like, "Goodbye, Leon, that's using your head, Roy." And all the while I wondered if my reflexes had stopped working. I uncrossed my knees. Would the pieces of me fall off one by one like the rusted, useless wheels and cogs of a worthless machine that has outlived its purpose?
In about 2 minutes, we'll have every door and exit covered.
You're certain that he's the man we're looking for?
The porter's positive. He saw him crossing the street, followed him a block, almost lost him at the light, but ran and caught up just as our Mr. X entered this building. And unfortunately, he got to the elevator before the Van Barth guy could alert us.
Oh, I see.
In addition to the porter, a night bartender from the Van Barth, waitress from Gill's, and the art dealer have all arrived.
Well, I've nothing to do now but wait, huh?
If he doesn't come out during the afternoon, we're sure to pick him up at 5:30 when the building empties.
It'll be jammed. We'll have to cover every inch of the main floor.
He's in the bag. We can't miss. Agree, George?
In the bag. And I'll wait it out right along with him. Stay here till we get him. If necessary, I'll sleep here all night. I'm not going to leave this office till we've got this all sewed up. Roy would know that if a man came into a building and didn't go out, he must logically still be inside. And this inescapable conclusion must eventually be followed by one, and only one, logical course of action. Sooner or later, my staff must go through the building, floor by floor, office by office, looking for the only man in it who never went home. That man would be me.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Desperate Witness. I'm Rod Serling.
Today's episode brought to you in part by General Motors and Quaker State Motor Oil. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater. Heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow and once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.